Thanks to the steam-powered industrial revolution of the 19th century, our entire Western civilization and energy-hungry way of life was pretty much built on lumps of this stuff, which, if you're Scott Pruitt, former head of the American Environmental Protection Agency, is called solid hydrocarbon, and which, if you're a normal human being living in the real world, is called coal. Fast forward to the year 2020, and thankfully this stuff, and the other hydrocarbons that I guess Mr. Pruitt would call liquid and gaseous, have now been completely replaced by renewable sources of energy like wind, solar and hydropower, coupled with micro and macro energy storage systems, all linked up via globally connected smart grids, allowing the free flowing distribution of energy across continents and time zones. That means none of us ever again need to worry about either a lack of power at any time of day or night, or any ill effects on our atmosphere like the ones that used to be caused by the CO2 and other emissions from the burning of fossil fuels. This isn't right. Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. We all know, of course, that the utopian vision of human energy use in the year 2020 that I just suggested is sadly not true. There are plenty of very knowledgeable people out there who will provide a range of technical and economic explanations as to why we haven't yet completely phased out our fossil fuels in the global energy mix. But essentially, we haven't done it yet because until relatively recently, as a species, we've simply chosen not to. And because here in the West, in the latter part of the 20th century, we dragged our feet on developing renewable technologies at pace, we found ourselves embarrassingly ill-prepared when hundreds of millions of other human beings in developing nations began walking out of rural villages and into urban environments in order to enjoy a similar standard of living to the one we've taken for granted for well over a century. And so, according to BP's 2019 Energy Outlook report, these solid, liquid and gaseous hydrocarbons still provide about 85% of the energy used across the world. Here's how the carbon dioxide emissions of the various hydrocarbons stack up. The amount of CO2 produced when a fuel is burnt is a function of the carbon content of the fuel. The heat content, or the amount of energy produced when a fuel is burnt, is mainly determined by the carbon and hydrogen content of the fuel. Heat produced when carbon and hydrogen combine with oxygen during combustion. Natural gas, which is essentially methane, has a higher energy content compared to other fuels, and that's why it's got a relatively low CO2 to energy content. So the table tells us that coal, in all its forms, gives out by far the most CO2 emissions of all the fossil fuels, which is why there's a big focus on eradicating it altogether from the energy mix. This great animation from the folks at the YouTube channel Trending Worlds shows how coal use in various parts of the world has evolved since I was born in 1969. Back then there were only 3.6 billion human beings on the planet, and coal consumption was dominated by the Western industrialized nations, led very clearly by the powerhouse that was the United States of America. But even then, China was already 5 years into what it called the Third Front Movement, involving the migration of millions of rural workers away from their traditional agricultural livelihoods and into the comparatively well-paid but horrendously arduous and unhealthy jobs in the coal mines. By the mid-1990s, annual production of electricity from coal in China had reached over 744 million megawatt hours, with over 60,000 mines in operation nationally. At the beginning of the new century, China joined the World Trade Organization, which caused a renewed surge in production and massive profits for the state-owned mines. The Chinese government saw an opportunity here, and they started to auction off mining rights to investors from the electricity and petroleum industries, causing an inevitable further acceleration in growth. Even the financial crisis of 2008, which brought the rest of the world to its knees, didn't make much of a dent in China's coal production, mainly due to the vast quantities of cash that the state government were able to plough into the industry. By 2015, China's thunderous economic growth was beginning to slow, and it had made emission reduction pledges at the Paris Climate Conference, including a huge increase in solar and wind power installations and a reduction in coal production of 1 billion tons by 2020. So what does the overall global coal power industry look like today? Well, in December of 2019, the International Energy Agency published its annual analysis of the global coal industry, and this year it presented a bit of a mixed bag of conclusions. It told us Coal remains a major fuel in global energy systems, accounting for almost 40% of electricity generation and more than 40% of energy-related carbon dioxide emissions. The report finds that although coal power generation is estimated to have declined in 2019, over the next 5 years, global coal demand is forecast to remain stable, supported by the resilient Chinese market, which now accounts for half of global consumption. And the picture varies considerably from region to region around the world. Over in the States, despite Mr. Trump's declaration of undying love for beautiful, clean coal, The Guardian reported new federal data showing that in April 2019, the United States generated more electricity from renewable sources than from coal for the first time. The article went on to say that although Mr. Trump has repeatedly promised to revive the coal industry by repealing various clean air and climate regulations, in reality, at least 50 coal-fired power plants have shut down since the current president entered the White House in 2017. The International Energy Agency points out that much of the coal industry decline in many states of the US is less a result of renewable energy and more as a result of the shale gas revolution over there, which according to this report has dramatically increased global methane emissions in the past decade. At the risk of using an accidentally highly appropriate cliche, there's a real danger here that we may have jumped out of the frying pan and into the fire. Methane is not just a product of the shale gas industry, it's also an emission byproduct from coal, as the IEA themselves point out. They estimated that the amount of methane seeping from new and disused coal mines may have reached just under 40 million tonnes in 2018. A tonne of methane has a similar atmospheric warming effect as about 30 tonnes of carbon dioxide. Using that number, annual coal mine emissions are the equivalent of those from international aviation and shipping sectors combined. Nevertheless, there is a relentless push towards renewable energy in many parts of the Union. At least 24 states have publicly declared their commitment to the pledges made at the Paris 2015 Climate Conference. And in the absence of national policy, states like New York and California have pledged to completely phase out the use of fossil fuels. Here in Europe, there was what could be almost described as a collapse of the coal market, with coal generation falling by a fifth in the first half of 2019, and almost every coal-burning country cutting back. Western Europe saw particularly dramatic drops in production, up to 79% in Ireland, according to a climate think tank called Sandbag. And there were times of zero or near zero generation in many countries. The UK, for example, switched off its coal plants for a fortnight in May for the first time. In absolute terms, Germany saw the biggest drop, but it remained responsible for over a third of the coal generation in the EU in 2019, according to Sandbag's analysis. Germany gave itself a big logistical headache when it chose to close its nuclear power stations following the Fukushima nuclear accident in 2012. That decision resulted in Germany becoming the world's biggest producer of lignite, which is the dirtiest grade of coal. But a recent agreement is set to make the country a coal-free zone by 2038, paving the way for a transition to cleaner energy sources. The German government aims to generate at least 65% of the nation's electricity needs from renewable sources by 2030. In 2018, coal generated around 35% of Germany's electricity, compared to an EU average of about 20%. So in order to achieve their renewable target, a $45 billion compensation package will support the closure of the lignite mines and coal-fired power stations, compensating mines and utilities for lost production revenues, and funding new infrastructure projects in those areas, which will hopefully help the 25,000 or so people currently working in the German coal industries to receive priority retraining into new jobs in the renewable energy sector. But not unlike the United States, a great deal of the energy transition away from coal across Europe is still being driven by natural gas, with all the same emissions challenges they have across the pond, so we're not yet in a position to regard ourselves as any kind of paragons of virtue. Over in Asia, the world's largest democracy, India, with around 1.4 billion inhabitants, achieved renewable power investments that topped those of fossil fuel-based power for the third year in a row in 2019, and spending on solar panels, supported by government auctions, exceeded spending on coal power for the first time. Despite its vast population, India is still a relatively modest energy consumer, particularly in comparison to the United States, but demand is set to climb rapidly as its population gets richer. The country's share of global energy demand will double by 2040, according to analysis by BP, and almost half of this new demand will be met by coal. India spent more than $20 billion on its grid last year, and the Central Electricity Authority estimates an extra $40 billion of transmission will be needed in the next 3 years to support the rapid rise in energy demand. Prime Minister Narendra Modi announced massive solar investments back in 2015 when the Paris climate pledges were made, but coal is still perceived by many as a cheap source of energy to feed India's increasing demand for power. China remains the dominant driver of any future energy transition. Global success or failure may well hinge on the decisions taken by President Xi Jinping over the coming years. He's quick to proclaim the green energy transition that his country is undergoing alongside the Belt and Road Initiative, and it's certainly true to say that China is installing mind-boggling quantities of solar and wind power each year. In 2019, the figures look like this, dwarfing anything anywhere else on the planet. But a report by Global Energy Monitor suggests that China's growing appetite for new coal-fired power stations has outstripped plant closures in the rest of the world since the start of last year. While other countries reduced their capacity by 8 gigawatts in the 18 months to June of 2019, over the same period, China increased its capacity by 42.9 gigawatts. Christine Shearer, an analyst at the NGO Global Energy Monitor, said China's proposed coal expansion is so far out of alignment with the Paris Agreement that it would put the necessary reductions in coal power out of reach, even if every other country were to completely eliminate its coal fleet. And China's reach is also global, helping to finance a quarter of all the new coal projects in the rest of the world, including in South Africa, Pakistan, and Bangladesh. China's coal investments, including domestic projects, mean it's backing more than half of all global coal power capacity under development. Jeanette Bergen, the head of responsible investment at Norway's largest pension fund, KLP, said China should be able to break its addiction to coal by using clean alternatives. She said China has a strong advantage that it is a global leader in solar and wind power, and last year it sold more electric cars than the rest of the world combined. China can become the world's foremost clean energy superpower, but she said the country must align itself with what is almost a worldwide consensus. All coal plants are toxic investments, and clean coal is a myth. And there are other countries who are also exporting very large quantities of coal, most notably Australia, Indonesia, and Russia. Despite not featuring as large coal consumers on the world stage themselves, they actually make up the world's three largest exporters of coal, with Australia head and shoulders above the rest. In a recent debate at the World Economic Forum in Davos, Australian Finance Minister Matthias Cormann had an interesting justification for Australia's exports.
Australia's got a great potential to contribute to emissions reductions globally. And let me say that black coal out of Queensland, for example, which is lower in ash and lower in moisture than other options being burned in developing countries around the world, can make a contribution to help reduce global greenhouse gas emissions.
But hiding behind domestic reductions in fossil fuel use while exporting the raw material to other parts of the world for different countries to burn instead arguably highlights the completely skewed, narrow-minded, nationalistic thinking that we're still collectively afflicted by. These global energy transition decisions look like they're only going to actually achieve the desired emissions reduction results if they're made in a cooperative, collaborative, and multilateral manner. As we run up to the COP26 meeting in Glasgow in November this year, countries are scrambling to demonstrate that they are on track to meet the pledges they made at Paris in 2015. According to the IEA report, when the Paris Agreement was signed in 2015, coal demand was in the midst of a three-year decline. Non-governmental players, such as investors and companies, have shown a strong commitment to acting on climate change, and public opposition to fossil fuels, particularly coal, is growing. Competition from natural gas and increasingly from renewables is coinciding with carbon pricing and policies to phase out coal in power generation. And that raises the final question for this week. What about the jobs and livelihoods of all those people currently working in the coal industry around the world? We saw Germany's plan earlier to help workers in the fossil fuel industry migrate across to the renewable sector. In the United States, according to the International Renewable Energy Agency, there are already about 855,000 workers in the renewable energy sector compared to around 50,000 in the coal industry. State-by-state retraining programs do exist, but the transition may not be as simple as that. This article in Gizmodo warns that there are barriers to a mass jobs movement, not least of which is geography. The article points out that solar and wind jobs pop up in places where sunshine and wind are abundant. Sunny California leads the solar industry, with 40% of all solar jobs found in the state. Iowa, Kansas, and South Dakota exemplify the potential for wind energy in the Midwest, with a quarter of each state's total electricity production coming from wind. Even Texas, well known for its oil resources, produced 13% of its electricity from wind in 2016. But the report asks, could solar or wind jobs pop up in major coal mining states like Wyoming, West Virginia, or Kentucky? A recent report published by Finland's Lapin Ranta University of Technology, or LUT, predicts that solar power will become the undisputed top global energy employer by 2050, spearheading a renewables job boom as coal and other fossil fuel industries shed millions of workers. They reckon renewables will grow to host 80% of all direct energy sector jobs by 2050, from 28% in 2015. According to their estimates, solar PV would account for 22.2 million of the 34 million direct energy sector jobs created by the solar PV sector, followed by energy storage at 4.5 million, with the rest coming from bioenergy, hydropower, and wind. As is so often the case in our struggle to find ways to rapidly address the growing climate crisis that now confronts us, the move from coal and other fossil fuels towards the utopian clean renewable energy societies of the future looks like it'll prove to be extremely complicated and contentious. No doubt you've got views, news, and suggestions of your own, which I'd love to hear about in the comments section below. That's it for this week though. A big thank you to those of you that joined us over at Patreon in the last 7 days. If you haven't had a look over there yet, then go to www.patreon.com/justhaveathink, where you can find out how you can join the growing group, contribute to wider climate strategy discussions, and directly influence the direction of the channel via monthly Patreon exclusive polls. You can of course also support the channel absolutely for free by subscribing and clicking on the little bell icon, so you get notified whenever new content comes out each week. As I'm sure you know, subscriber numbers are the lifeblood of any YouTube channel because they help to get content noticed by the somewhat random YouTube search algorithms. And for us, that means getting a message of climate change mitigation in front of as many people as possible each week. Dead easy to subscribe, of course. You just need to click down there or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.